pain. So together it is head pain. Cerebellar, which means pertaining or related to cerebellum. Cerebellitis. If you have itis as the suffix, which means inflammation. So inflammation of cerebellum. Cerebral, pertaining or related to cerebrum. Cerebrospinal, pertaining to cerebrum as well as the spine. So for example, cerebrospinal fluid, the fluid present in the brain and spinal cord. So for that words, you will have this cerebrospinal. Electroencephalogram. This is very similar to ECG and EMG. So in all these things, we use to record the brain electricity. Encephalitis. Encephalo means brain. So itis is inflammation. Encephalitis. Brain inflammation. Meningioma. If you get oma as suffix, which means tumor. So meningioma, which means meninges tumor. So meningeal, pertaining or related to the meninges. Meningitis, inflammation of the meninges. And neural, pertaining to the nerve. Neuralgia, nerve pain. Neurectomy, surgical removal of the nerve. Neurologist, the nerve specialist. Neuroma, which is nerve tumor. So oma means tumor. Itis is inflammation. Algia is pain. And ectomy is surgical removal. And if you have ology, which means study, ologist means specialist. Nephropathy. Pathy means disease. So nerve disease. Neuroplasty, which is surgical repair of the nerve. Plasty is surgical repair. Polyneuritis. Neuritis means inflammation of the nerves. Polyneuritis is inflammation of many nerves. Neuroruffy. Oruffy means suturing. So neuroruffy means suturing of the nerves. Myelogram. Myelo is spinal cord. Gram means record. So recording of the spinal cord is myelogram. Myelitis. Inflammation of the spinal cord. For example, poliomyelitis. Inflammation of the gray matter of the spinal cord. Polio means gray matter. Pontine, which is pertaining to pons. Radiculitis, nerve root inflammation. Radiculo means nerve root. Radiculopathy, nerve root disease. Thalamic, pertaining to thalamus. Intrathecal, so pertaining to inside the meninges. So theca means sheets. So the sheets that covering the brain and spinal cord are the meninges. Intra means inside. So coming to the vocabulary part related to the nervous system. Anesthesiology. So which is the use of anesthesia for surgical procedures and resuscitation and for pain management. So the use of anesthesia in surgical, we call it as anesthesiology. Neurology. Diagnosis and treatment of diseases particularly related to the nervous system. Neurosurgery. So treating the nervous system by surgery. Aura. So before the sensation of epileptic seizure, prior to the epileptic seizure, or normally in a normal terms, we call it as fits. Prior to the epileptic seizure or fits or migraine. Migraine is a chronic type of headache. So prior getting this, they'll have some sensations like seeing colors, like prior warnings. If they have this abnormal things getting into their mind before getting the fits, that means they are about to get that. So which we call it as aura. Aura means these are the prior warnings. Convulsions. Convulsions means strong involuntary contraction, which is not under our control. Strong involuntary muscle contractions as well as relaxations, which happens alternatively, and we don't know when it will start and we can't control how to stop it. And seizures. Seizures are sudden, uncontrollable onset of symptoms. So these are also like convulsions, so such as epileptic seizure. Focal seizure means the fits or a seizure that is particular to the hand or leg. So particular to one body part, that we call it as focal seizure. Focal means directing to the particular area. Syncope, this is the medical term for fainting. Conscious means awake and aware of the surroundings. When the person is awake, and oriented if we ask the person where he is and whom he is talking to and what is the time, whether it is morning, evening, or where he is, whether he is in the hospital or in the house, to whom he is talking, whether he is talking to the doctor or whom, relative. So that awakening we call it as consciousness. Unconsciousness is unaware of the surroundings. So unable to respond to any stimuli, whether it was a touch, temperature, pain, to all the sensations, they won't respond. That condition we call it as unconsciousness. Coma. So prolonged state of unconsciousness, we call it as coma. Paresthesia. For some people, due to diabetes or due to some neural diseases, they'll have burning sensation, burning and tingling sensation in the both the legs. That we call it as paresthesia. Tremors. Tremors are like shivering. Involuntary. This is also involuntary, which is not under our control, which is repetitive alternating movements. Alternating contraction and relaxations. Delirium, which is a confusion, disorientation. They don't know where they are and what they are doing. And agitation. They'll have continuous, they'll have a hyper anger situations that we call it as agitation. Even they break the things also. Dementia. Dementia is impaired intellectual function, like reasoning, problem solving, judgment. Everything will be defective for dementia people. And the memory also. And hemiparesis. Weakness of the entire one side of the body, we call it as hemiparesis. Hemi means half. Paresis means weakness of the body. Paralysis. Temporary or permanent loss of the voluntary control of the body. If you see a person who is paralytic, then you can't expect a person to have a voluntary control. So their body will not listen to them. And hemiplegia. Paralysis to one side of the body. Paresis means weakness. They can able to move. But in plegia, it is just the paralysis. They can't even move their finger also. So that is hemiplegia. Paralysis to one side of the body. Paraplegia. Paralysis particular to the lower legs. So lower portion of the body is paraplegia. Palsy. So losing the ability to control the movements is palsy. And coming to the brain pathology, Alzheimer's disease. So this is very common nowadays. Usually this disease will be above 60. And the person age was above 60, they may get Alzheimer's disease. So the disorder with progressive dementia, means progressive memory loss will be there. Disorientation. Sometimes they'll forget their relatives' names also. Their wife name, mother name, and what is the relation between them. That was advanced Alzheimer's. Apathy and loss of memory will be there. Astrocytoma. So astrocytes are a type of neuroglial cells present in the nervous system. So the cancer to the particular cells, we call it as astrocytoma. Brain tumor. So which is the intracranial mass, means a developing mass inside the brain. So it may be malignant. Malignant means it can spread to other areas also. Or benign. Benign means it can't spread to other areas. It only will be developing in particularly that area only. So it is very dangerous because it occupies the space inside the brain. Cerebral aneurysm. So ballooning of the cerebral artery leads to stroke also. Cerebral contusion. So bruising of brain from impact. Impact means, so if the person is having any accident or falling from the bike, or any sudden hit on the head region, that we call it as impact. So due to impact, the person's brain got bruising. If the symptoms are lasting longer than 24 hours, so including unconsciousness, giddiness, vomiting, and unequal pupils, that we call it as cerebral contusion. If the symptoms, the same symptoms lasting for less than 24 hours, then we call it as concussion. So if it is more than 24 hours, then it is contusion. If it is less than 24 hours, then we call it as concussion. Cerebral palsy. It was the brain damage due to the defect of, or due to the defect, any injury to the brain, or due to lack of oxygen at the time of birth of the baby, we call it as cerebral palsy or CP. Mostly the cerebral palsy childs are MR childs also. MR means mentally retarded. In 90% of the cases, both the things will be there. And CVA, cerebrovascular accident. So infarct means the death of the brain cells due to loss of blood supply to the brain part. So the loss of blood supply may be because of an injury, maybe because of an hemorrhage, thrombus, embolus, or anything. Anything may be the reason. Finally, the blood supply to the particular part of the brain will get stopped. So if the blood supply got stopped, then the brain cells will die. So dying of the brain cells, we call it as infarction. Transient ischemic attack. So this is also very similar to the CVA, and the symptoms will last for less than 48 hours. And it was very temporary. It was a warning sign for the person. He may get stroke in future. Migraine. Migraine is a specific type of severe headache. So they'll be very sensitive to the light. Giddiness and nausea will be very common. Epilepsy. Epilepsy is a seizures with loss of consciousness. So which is caused by uncontrolled electrical activity in the brain. So it was like a short circuit in the brain. So suddenly they'll have high intensity of electrical impulses that will be generated in the brain. That leads to fits or epilepsy or seizures. Tonic-clonic seizures. These are a very stronger epileptic seizures. We also call it as grand mal. Absence seizure. So this is the person will have the fits, but the awareness of the surroundings will be lost, and the activity also. We formerly called petit mal seizure. Hydrocephalus, which is accumulation of fluid inside the brain. Within the ventricles, we call it as hydrocephalus. Parkinson's disease, which is the chronic disease of brain with tremors, weakness, muscle rigidity, and shuffling gait. Reese syndrome, which is an acute encephalopathy. Encephalopathy means disease to the brain. And also it leads to organ damage, mostly because of viral infection or taking too much of aspirin. ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. So the degeneration of motor neurons. Motor neurons are nothing but the neurons which travels from brain to the muscles, we call it as motor neurons, which obeys the commands of the brain to respond. So if the degeneration of motor neurons happens, the person will lose the voluntary control on the muscles. So we also call this disease as Lou Gehrig's disease, because of the discoverer name. Poliomyelitis, as I told already, myelitis means inflammation of spinal cord. Poliomyelitis is inflammation, particularly to the gray matter of the spinal cord. This is because of viral infection, and we all know that virus is poliovirus. So the damage may be temporary or permanent. So the person will be having paralysis, particularly to one leg or hands and leg may also be affected. Spinal cord injury. So due to any trauma or any accident, if the injury to the spinal cord, so the injury will be permanent. The person cannot be recovered from that paralysis. Lifelong, he has to be fixed in the wheelchair only if anything happens to the spinal cord. Spina bifida. I'll show you in the picture. So this is actually spina bifida. So this is the vertebra. So what happens here is, this is anterior part of the vertebra. Anterior means front of the vertebra. This is back side of the vertebra. So here the problem is, the back side of the vertebra will fail to fuse. There will be a space left here. So when the space is left here, so this actually we call it a spina bifida. So because the spinous process will be failing to fuse, this we call it a spinous process. Here, the spinous process failed to fuse. So the space was left here. So what happens here is, so the spinal cord and the meninges was directly exposed under the skin. So here there will be a marking like tuft of hair. You can see here in this picture, these are meninges and this is spinal cord. And these are nerve roots. And from the nerve roots, the nerve fibers will be coming out. So it has two types. One is meningocele. Another one is myelomeningocele. In the meningocele, in this space, the meninges will be protruding out along with the CSF. This we call it as meningocele. So along with the meninges, if the spinal cord is also protruding out, then we call it as myelomeningocele. And now pathology, Bell's palsy. So if one side of the face alone get the paralysis due to inflammation of the facial nerve, which is the seventh cranial nerve, then we call it as Bell's palsy. Mostly the people will get this infection, viral infection, during cold climate. When the person have a habit of going to a walk by 5 o'clock or 4 o'clock, they usually will get Bell's palsy due to the cold. And Guillain-Barré syndrome. So this is the loss, temporary loss of myelin sheath, which is an autoimmune disease. Our own antigens will fight with our own antibodies. First, initially, it will start in the legs. From the legs, it will progress to upwards. And finally, it will attack the heart and lungs, and the person will die within a period of 9 to 10 years. Multiple sclerosis. This is also a loss of myelin sheath, but the person will have weakness and numbness. Progressively, it may take. Myasthenia gravis. Myo means muscle. Asthenia is weakness. Gravis means death of the muscle. So initially, the muscles will become weak. And later, the muscle fibers will die. That we call it as myasthenia gravis. This is because insufficient neurotransmitter. And singles, which is painful eruption of blisters on the nerve path. So because of herpes zoster virus. Epidural hematoma and subdural hematoma. I'll show you in this picture. So in this picture, this is actually the subdural hematoma. In meninges, we have three layers, dura mater, arachnoid matter, and pia mater. If the space below the dura mater, we call it as subdural space. If there is any rupture of the blood vessels, that leads to bleeding in this area. After bleeding, what happens? The blood will get clot here. So the blood clot happened in the subdural region, then we call it as subdural hematoma. If the blood clot is happened in the epidural region, then we call it as epidural hematoma. So where is the blood clot? That was the reason. So this is also has to be treated immediately. So because otherwise it leads to brain damage and the person may die also. Coming to the clinical laboratory test, CSF, cerebrospinal fluid analysis. If anything issue with our body, immediately we go for a blood check. Likewise, if any issue with the brain and spinal cord, like encephalitis, poliomyelitis, neuroma, if any of the case like infections or any tumor, so they can go for a cerebrospinal fluid analysis, the complete examination of CSF to detect the infections or any blood or any abnormal fluid in the brain. Brain scan, so which comes under the nuclear medicine. So the image of the brain after injecting the radioactive isotopes. So then they can see the entire brain for each and every gyri and sulci. The small areas also will be visible in the brain scan. Cerebral angiography. Cerebral means brain. Angio means blood vessel. Graphy means taking an X-ray. So the process of taking an X-ray, particularly to the brain blood vessels. So by injecting the radio opaque dye. In the normal X-ray, they can't view the blood vessels that easily. So that's why they have to inject the dye. Echoencephalography, nothing but ultrasound to the brain. So this was very similar to the ultrasound taken in the pregnancy. There, the ultrasound, they'll check how the baby is. Here, the ultrasound to check the brain. Myelography, so taking an X-ray of the spinal cord after injecting a radio opaque dye. In most of the X-rays in this nervous system, they will inject the radio opaque dye or else they can't see the organs properly. And PET, positron emission tomography. This is actually to see the metabolic activity of the brain, whether the brain areas are active or not. So they will use the positive radionucleotides to construct an image of the brain. So to see the metabolic activity, whether which part of the brain is functioning and which part of the brain is non-functioning, particularly PET is taken during CVA, cerebrovascular accident, or during brain stroke. And coming to the additional test, Babinski reflex. So when the person is having stroke, what the doctor uses to do a physical examination is, he will strike on the foot with the knee hammer. and he will see whether the toes are moving or not. If the toes are moving, then the person can have a better recovery from the stroke. If the toes are not moving, then the person recovery will be very late. So that the checking we call it as, that sign we call it as Babinski reflex. And electroencephalography, recording the electrical activity of the brain. Lumbar puncture, this is for CSF analysis. In order to drain the CSF fluid, they will put a shot on the lumbar area with the injection. So then they will drain the fluid from the lumbar area, the CSF. And nerve conduction velocity. If there is any condition like neuroma or any injury to the nerve or any cut to the nerve, so they will go for this test, nerve conduction velocity test, with how much speed the electrical signals are traveling along the nerve. If the speed decreases or if the speed is lost, then there is something happen in between the nerve. Then they will confine with that. Carotid endarterectomy. So carotid arteries are the arteries which supplies the blood to the brain. So if there is any blockage or any blood clot in these arteries, what they'll do is they will remove that clot. So by removing the inner lining of the artery. Cerebrospinal fluid shunting. If the person is having hydrocephalus, they will shunt the CSF fluid to the abdominal cavity. Laminectomy. So if there is any pressure on the spinal cord, they will remove a part of vertebra. So that we call it as laminectomy. And tractotomy. Surgical cut of the nerve tract to treat the severe chronic pain. So coming to the pharmacology. So analgesics, which treats the minor or moderate pain, which is non-narcotic. And anesthetic. Anesthetic means loss of sensation or consciousness. Analgesias are given for particular to treat the pain. Anesthetics are given particularly to loss, all the entire sensations will be lost. Anticonvulsant, this is to treat the seizures like focal seizure, grand mal, petit mal seizure. For all type of the seizures, they'll give anticonvulsant drugs. Dopaminergic drugs, this is to treat the Parkinson's disease. Hypnotics. Hypnotics will promote the sleep. And narcotic analgesics, this is for the severe pain. Sedative. Sedative is for calming or relaxing effect.